Patient diagnosis, workup, investigation, intervention, and treatment. And in the end, we will discuss the case scenario. So, lower GI hemorrhage defined as abnormal intraluminal blood loss from the source of distal to the teres ligament. The teres ligamentum is basically, it is also called a DJ junction. So, the below the DJ junction, distal to the DJ junction, always a bleed comes in the rectal area. It's called lower GI hemorrhage. You can see here, DJ junction is basically starts from the end of the duodenum and the beginning of the jejunum. So, you can see over here. If you over here, it's a D1, D2, D3, D4, and this is a stomach. You can see the fundus of the stomach, and you can see here it connects with the last end part of the duodenum, and it communicates with the stomach. It's called DJ. It's called a DJ junction. ठीक है, stomach connects with the D1 and ends. The duodenum ends on a D4, and D4 continues to the jejunum, the supremum. So this is called DJ junction. You can see here, it's a DJ flexure. So the lower GI bleeding is classified as a massive, moderate, and mild. You can see in this chart, this is lower GI bleeding. It's a massive bleeding, moderate bleeding, and occult bleeding. So a patient who, so it has been divided into different bleeding of the bleed. If there is a massive bleed, the patient is greater than 65 years of age with multiple medical problems, it can cause a massive bleeding, and it is also present with the hematochexia or bright red blood rectum. Hemodynamically, it could be less than stable. The systolic blood pressure could be less than 90, and heart rate could be the 100, and low urine output. Hemoglobin would be the 6. Below the 6 R would be the 6, and most commonly due to the, and the most common cause of massive bleeding in a greater age is the diverticulosis and angiodysplasia. Moderately, it may be higher than 21%. So if you're talking about the moderate bleeding, the patient could be any age. It could be the more than 65, it could be the younger age. Patient present with the hemochexia or melena. And the hemodynamically patient would be the stable because it's moderate bleeding, and long list of diseases including a benign and rectal congenital inflammatory and a neoplastic disease, moderate amount of acute and chronic bleeding. Occult bleeding, patient with any age, patient present with a macrocytic hemochromic anemia due to a chronic bleeding loss. Long list of diseases including congenital inflammatory and neoplastic disease may cause occult bleeding. So the lower GI bleeding has been divided into three types: massive, moderate, and occult. Depend upon the patient's age and depend upon the presentation of. So we will discuss individually. The massive lower GI bleeding is a passage of large volume of the red or maroon blood through the red. When they're passing, when their loss of the large volume of the red blood in our form of the body, it could be hemodynamic and instability and shock. So still blood pressure less than 90. Initial decrease in hematocrit level of 6 or less. Transfusion of at least 2 units of packed red vessels. Bleeding that continues for 3 days. So significant rebleeding in 1 week. Differential diagnosis would be what? The differential diagnosis. Now, the diagnosis of anal conditions which presents with a pain and bleeding is called fissure. If there is a pain with lump and bleeding, it's called it could be the prolapsed hemorrhoids, carcinoma of anal canal, prolapsed of rectal polyp, or carcinoma and the prolapsed rectum. So, diagnosis of the condition presenting with a rectal bleeding but no pain. So the blood mixed with the stool skull, it could be from the colon. Blood shows the streak on the stool, could be the rectal. So the blood after defecation can be from the hemorrhoids. Blood and mucus is called colites. Blood alone diverticular disease. Melena is from the peptic ulcer. So in differential diagnosis, first we have discussed about the what is the massive lower GI bleeding, what is the moderate, and what would be the occult. After the discussing this story, after discussing that, we talked about the massive lower GI bleeding. What is the massive bleeding? So massive lower GI bleeding, when we will say it's a massive lower GI bleeding, we will say if the blood pressure becomes 90 or less than 90 because of the blood loss, we can say it's a large volume of the, when we can see there's a large volume of the red blood or maroon colored blood comes from it. We can see if there's a hemoglobin level, hematocrit level becomes strict, nucleus becomes low, and the hemoglobin level becomes fixed. It's not hematocrit, the hemoglobin level becomes fixed. And if because of lower GI bleed, you start to transfusion of the units of PEG cell volume. So 2 units PEG cell volume at a time, this it could be it, it is so we can label it is a massive lower GI bleeding. So bleeding continues since 3 days, and again bleed starts since 1 week. Again starts significant bleed loss, again. So it is all about massive lower GI bleeding. You can call massive lower GI bleeding when these kind of effect occurs. Either it continues bleeding, either it rebleeds in 1 week, either you are going to transfuse the two pint of the red blood cells, either initially you are either the you can go for the CBC and you saw that there's 6 hemoglobin level, either patient is hemodynamically instable. So how would you differentiate that? Now we have to put the differential diagnosis. If the bleeding occurs with a pain, it could be the fissure. If there is a pain, lump, and bleeding, it could be the hemorrhoid, it could be the carcinoma, it could be the rectal polyp, it could be prolapsed rectum. So another deficient diagnosis presenting with the rectal bleeding but no pain. So that is deficient diagnosis of the bleeding comes with the pain, and that deficient diagnosis comes with the rectal bleeding but no pain. So bleed mixed with the stool is called colon carcinoma, bleed streak on a stool called rectal carcinoma, bleed after defecation called hemorrhoids, bleed and mucus colitis, bleed alone diverticular disease, and malignant is a peptic ulcer. So bleed mixed with the stool colon carcinoma, bleed streak on a stool rectal carcinoma, bleed after defecation hemorrhoids, bleed and mucus colitis, bleed alone diverticular disease, and malignant. Lower GI hemorrhage in adults percentage of patient, diverticular disease is 60%, diverticulosis, diverticulitis of small intestine, diverticulosis, diverticulitis of colon is 60%. Inflammatory bowel disease is a Crohn disease, and ulcerative colitis 13%. Benign anorectal disease like hemorrhoid, fissure, and fistula 11%. So neoplasia malignant is 9% of small intestine, malignant new colon. Coagulopathy and enterovenous malformation total 100%. So the percentage of patient occurs. The most common cause of the lower GI bleeding is a diverticulitis. So if the question arises, what is the more normal, what is the most common cause of the lower GI bleeding? Lower GI hemorrhage in children and adolescents, what is called polyp and polyposis syndrome. So diverticulosis is the most common cause of lower GI bleeding. Lower GI hemorrhage in children is called intussusception. Polyps and polyposis syndromes. Juvenile polyp, polyposis, the Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, or familial endocrinitis polyps, and inflammatory bowel disease is the most common cause. Hemorrhoids. It is one of the common cause of the rectal bleeding. The causes, it could be the carcinoma can cause the hemorrhoids, it could be the pregnancy, chronic constipation, also heart failure, excessive use of laxatives and portal hypertension are the causes. These are the causes of the hemorrhoids. Laxatives are the cause of hemorrhoids. Constipation is the cause of the hemorrhoids. Carcinoma is the cause of the portal hypertension. Excessive use of laxatives. These all are the causes of the hemorrhoids. So what are the types of the hemorrhoids? These are two types of the hemorrhoids. Internal hemorrhoids and external hemorrhoids. Internal hemorrhoids. So there is an inner rectal ray. Basically there is a rectum and the anus. Anus is the 4 cm. You can see here. This is the anal area. This is the 4 cm. All about the one breadth of the finger. And the 4 cm above the 4 cm is a rectum. All are the rectum. It's like about 11 to 12 cm long. And it continues to the sigmoid colon. So the rectosigmoid is from the rectosigmoid junction. It is a two halves. One goes the right valve, two are the left valve. So it shows it basically to put the pressure on the defecation. So this is above the dental line. Whatever above the dental line is called internal hemorrhoids, which are basically covered by the internal mucosa. These are the venous congestion. This is a venous congestion. This is a dilatation of the venous, the anal cushion. Dilatation of the anal cushion can cause the hemorrhoids. So the develops above the dental line, covered by the anal mucosa. Legs are sensory. It doesn't have any sensation because it is a painless, because it is above the dental line, and it shows a bright red and purple in color. Extra hemorrhoid basically arises below the dental line. Extra hemorrhoid arises basically below the dental line, covered by the sternum, covered by the squamous epithelium, as innervated by the inferior rectal nerve. innervated by the inferior rectal nerve. So it is a painful. Internal hemorrhoid drains into superior rectal veins and the protosystem external but into inferior rectal veins and inferior vena cava. So grading our internal types, basically internal hemorrhoids are classified by degree of tissue prolapse into the anal canal. Grade 1, they are confined to the anal canal with a minimal bleeding or maybe asymptomatic but do not prolapse. Grade 2, they prolapse and defecating or standing, then reduce spontaneously. Grade 3, prolapse without standing and requiring manual detection. Grade 4, the chronically prolapse and have reducible fallout, again another fallout of NS and are reducible, stabilized and surgical hemorrhage. So the grade, they are the four grades. Now you should know about the four grades of the internal hemorrhoids. The external hemorrhoids always occurs outside of the anal canal. So they doesn't go inside. It will becomes a thrombosis and becomes a painful because it is also presented externally. The internal could be the grade 1, could be the grade 2, either grade 3, either grade 4. Grade 3 is a manually reducible, grade 2 is spontaneously reducible, and grade 4 is a it could not be, it is a prolapse. So grade 1 usually are symptomatic or with a minimal bright red bleeding or defecation. So what would be the symptom? Symptom would be the earlier symptom, start bright red bleeding and surface of sternum palate. Number 2, if it becomes a prolapse, a much later symptom is a prolapse, start transient defecation but occurs with increasing frequency until third degree of hemato. Discharge, it can cause the mucus discharge accompanied as pruritus and pain. There are 4-5 main symptoms of the hemorrhoids. Grade 1, bleeding, prolapse, discharge, pruritus and pain. Hemorrhoid piles, basically they are show the signs. Patient should be left lateral position. How would you examine the patient? First you have to place the patient in a specific position. This is called left lateral position. The other types of positions are the lithotomy position, knee elbow position, modified left lateral position is called the Sims position. You have to put the patient in these different positions. You should know about the left lateral position. Then you have to inspect it. First degree hemorrhoid show no outward abnormality. You can't see the first degree hemorrhoid in a simple digital rectal examination, simple inspection. You can't see an inspection first degree. Second degree shows the skin covered component when the buttocks are separated apart by the prolapse there, where the patient stayed. Second, you can see when you are putting a buttocks outside and you can see there is a covering. Third degree shows the red and mucus position. So you go a digital examination. Now, after the inspection, third degree shows you the position of the hemorrhoid, C7-11 position. So you can see, you can diagnose your bias yourself, this is the hemorrhoid and you can go. After doing the inspection, you go for the DRE. This is internal hemorrhoids can't be felt and usually your thrombus are in the long standing coils and should not apply a parenchymal examination. So, sigmoidoscopy investigation, this is a sigmoidoscopy first. Sigmoidoscopy basically essential to exclude, co-exclude rectal pathology as a carcinoma or polyps. Very many more indicated when the sigmoidoscopy purposely can explain the symptoms. So CBC anemia and very happy in longest standing pipes. So investigation, you go for the sigmoidoscopy. It is essential to exclude the exclude basically rectal, any other rectal pathology. And very anemia basically indicated when the sigmoidoscopy or purposely can explain the disease. Hemorrhoid. So the anal or rectal cancer, Redunculated polyp, rectal prolapse, anal fissure or fistula or hematoma is painful. So the hemorrhoids and the differential diagnosis of hemorrhoids is the anal or rectal cancer. There is a redunculated polyps, rectal prolapse, anal fissure, fistula or hematoma. Complications include anemia, strangulation, thrombosis, ulceration, ganglion suppression, fibrosis. These all are the strangulation. What do you mean? What we mean for strangulation? When a prolapse pile become gripped by an external, so there's an external sphincter which grip the prolapsed pile and cause the strangulation. So this causes the thrombosis. Thrombosis lead to ulceration because there's a ischemia. Superficial ulceration of the exposed mucous membrane. The first degree hemorrhoid. In the first degree hemorrhoid, we go for the bulk of laxative and high dietary fiber may be enough to decrease the constipation. Injection therapy, Second degree ablation is basically can deal with this injection therapy. But for the first degree and early second degree MRI, you can go for the sclerotherapy. The 5 ml of the 5% phenol in elbow, I'll inject it to the special syringe into base of the pile, just above that. The base of the pile, just above that injection. Rubber bed ligation effective for first and second degree. A small ring rubber bed applied to a caustic mucosa at the base. This will lead to a strangulation of the pile and subsequent lifting of the pile over a period of 10 days. Infrared photocoagulation. Cryotherapy. Cryopop is applied to overlying mucosa. Stretching of venous sphincter improves the venous drainage and decreases the need for staining. Overstretching will lead to a healing continuous. Hemorrhoidectomy. Necessary for third degree of hemorrhoid or in a prolapse thrombosis. So the complication, these are the procedures you must know. First degree, you have used for laxatives and hydrative fibrin. Second injection is supposed to be the first and early second degree. Rubber band first and second degree. And infrared photocoagulation, cryotherapy, stretching of venous sphincter. But overstretching can lead to anal congestion, so avoid for that. Hemorrhoidectomy, necessary for the third degree or prolapse hemorrhoidectomy. So the 8 procedures you must know about. Carcinoma of rectum. The 75% in the lower part of the rectal ampulla. Papillifidus are simple ulcers with everted edges. So there are everted edges in the present in the lower part of the rectum. So 25% upper part of rectum anywhere in the shape. 90% of rectal cancer can be said to be the rectum. So the 75% lower part of the rectal ampulla. There is an ampulla. 75% mostly occur, which cancer occur in the ampulla. It's called papillifidus or simple ulcers with everted edges. 5% upper part of rectum anywhere in the shape. 90% rectal cancer can be said to be the rectum. So the microscopic appearance may be as follows: papillifidus ulcerating common stenosing or rectosigmoid aqua. So macroscopically, like the, you can see in the neck, the eyes through, there is a papillifidus, the papillus ulcerating, most common is ulcerating, stenosing is rectosigmoid and colite. 90% of adenocarcinoma, so the microscopic appearance is 90% of the adenocarcinoma, 9% of colite. Adenocarcinoma with mucous protection, 1% anaplastic carcinoma. The anus squamous cell carcinoma occur, but the malignant tumor protruding through the anal canal more likely to be an adenocarcinoma of rectum, when it is skin. Rectal carcinoma is common in the middle and old age, 50 70 years, but it can occur in young adults. This is equally common in both sexes. So, in a carcinoma of rectum, sign on examination, more commonly only in the lower edge of the malignant ulcer can be felt. Feels hard and bulges into the lumen of the rectum. The edges are inverted and the base is irregular. You can feel this is a base and irregular. Friable edges are inverted. You can cause this could be the tumor. Upon withdrawal of the finger, you will have a blood mucus on the left finger. If the tumor is on the upper part of the rectum, only a lower edge is felt. Disposition of lesion makes it hard to decide if tumor is in the rectum or out of it. Sigmoidoscopy is the answer. Disposition of the lesion makes it hard to decide if a tumor is in a rectum or out of it. Sigmoid is an answer. If the position of the lesion makes it too hard to decide if the tumor is in the rectum or out of it, so you can go for the sigmoidoscope. If it, you can see in rectal examination, you can compare there is a tumor, you can go for the sigmoidoscope. So after initial inspection, you go for the DRE, proctoscopy, then go for the sigmoidoscope. Perectal is not reliable in the fat people, so on general examination, the liver is the most common. So in the perectal examination, is not reliable in fat people, you can go for the On general examination, the liver is the most common site for metastasis. So you have to examine the liver for an abdomen, you have to go to examine. Other sites for metastasis are supraclavicular lymph node and lungs and skin. Lung metastasis is a concomitant, chest X-ray is a mandatory. The inguinal lymph node are involved only if the tumor is below the Hilton's line and to involve the skin. So lung metastasis is uncommon and chest X-ray is a mandatory. And the inguinal lymph node are involved only if the tumor is below the Hilton's line. So carcinoma of rectum, go for the sigmoidoscopy to inspect and take a biopsy. Bare minima, the indication for this procedures, the growth which you can't appreciate on sigmoidoscopy. If a second tumor is suspected, if you are thinking about a synergetic tumor, you can go for the bare minima. Ulcerative colitis and family polyposis and other pathology you can suspect in another pathology with the tumors, you can go for the perimenium. Ultrasound abdomen to check a liver metastasis in the site only for the metastatic ascites. Carcinoma of rectum is benign growth. Carcinoma of sigmoid prolapsing into a pouch of Douglas. Ovarian or uterine tumors, extension of a carcinoma in the prostate or cervix, diverticular disease, endometriosis, lymphatic granuloma, and finally, and the facies is not by the radiation examination. So the treatment is a curative surgery depends on the distance of a tumor from the anal verge. Upper third tumors, resection with anastomosis between the sigmoid and lower rectum, anterior resection. So the upper third tumors go for the resection with anastomosis between the sigmoid and lower rectum. It's also anterior resection. If the lower third tumors less than 5 cm from the anal verge are the treated by the abdominopedial excision of rectum plus terminal colostomy. And then go for the adjunctive radiotherapy to reduce the recurrence. The mid-third tumor anterior resection of distal clearance can be obtained. This is easier in women due to the wide pelvic. Palliative procedure, even if a secondary tumors are present, palliation is the best achieved when the primary is resected. Colostomy is necessary for the intestinal obstruction, but this doesn't relieve the bleeding restored at fracture pain. In an appropriate cases, deep X-ray therapy, diathermy or laser of the tumor may be given temporary relief with maybe cytotoxic drugs. Palliative procedure is a dead procedure which will only help to palliate the patient, not to the definitive management. So, diverticular disease. So now, the diverticular disease may present in one of the following manners: chronic left side abdominal pain, change in a bowel habits, acute abdominal symptoms, rectal bleeding, acute massive and fresh blood. The elderly patient with the disease is present with a little faint, lower abdominal pain, desire to defecate, and when the appetite pass, large volume of fresh blood involves. The patients are really shocked and don't require transfusion. It is diagnosed via very many minor colonoscopy. So here you can see, this is a basically a colon, where you can see there's a diverticula. It basically shows you. The two diverticula is come basically there is false and two diverticula. The false diverticula only include the mucosal layer, and the two diverticula covers the whole the three layers of the colon. You can see the outpouching. This is outpouching. These are the outpouching. You can see in a very many more. So fistula NNO. A fistula is a tract lined with the epithelium or granulation tissue. Connecting to epithelial surfaces. It may be connected to body cavities or one cavity in the body external surface. A fistula NNO connects the lumen of the rectum or any canal with the external surface. It is usually lined by the granulation tissue. Perianal hematoma. It is not a true hematoma but the hemorrhosis of vein in the subcutaneous plexus. Peri is usually due to the tension. It begins gradually increasing in severity over a few hours and subsiding gradually over a few days. It is a continuous made worse by sitting, moving and defecating. Localized lump. Swelling appears at the same time as the lump, first in the small spherical, then it may when large become more painful. This happens only if the lump bursts. Bleeding basically when happens, lump bursts as skin over the lump ulcerates. The skin around the lump is itchy and the moist due to leakage of the mucus because of the lump doesn't allow the anus close properly. You can see the picture. I can't put the picture over there because so differentiated. Well, perineal hematoma sign and examination shows the color. If it is close to the overlying skin which is not edematous, it is a deep red purple. But if the skin is edematous, then this color can be seen. Lump is tender, especially it ulcerates. Initially, the lump is spherical and up to 1 cm diameter. If the skin is lax or edematous, then the lump is polypoid. Lump is spherical and up to 1 cm diameter. If the skin is lax or edematous, then the lump is polypoid. Covered by skin and surface beneath it is smooth. Solid, hard, and hemispherical mass. The lump is superficial to external symptom. Also, the skin, other structures. So, the official NNO The anal fissure is a longitudinal split in the skin of the anal canal. Acute fissures basically common in children who pass bulky stool. Chronic fissures are most common in the age of 20 and 40 years. Chronic fissures are common in a woman after childbirth. Anal fissures are more common in men than a woman. Multiple fissures may complicate Crohn's disease. Fissure anum. The fissures are the commonest cause of pain in the anal verge. Both acute and chronic fissure are very painful. It begins at defecation and is described with tearing. It persists for minutes to hours after defecation with a thrombing or etching in nature. Bleeding. Acute fissures may streak the stool with the blood and stain the toilet paper. Chronic fissure bleed less and may bleed toilet paper if any. A small skin tag called sentinel tag or centripetal may form at the lower end of chronic fissure. This tag may be filled apart. Because of the pain, the patient usually is constipated. The fibrosis around the chronic fissure prevents a good seal around the anus, leading to small amount of mucus leak on the perianal skin. Pruritus could be the presenting symptom of chronic fissure. The symptoms are slow to develop and become a long-standing. There may be a period of remission. The fissure diagnosis of Crohn's disease, trauma, and abuse of children. So the acute fissures, if early fissure, early and small, may heal spontaneously. Local anesthetic ointment and lubricant laxatives are enough. The relief lubrication of gentian cream will exercise. And as we have to aim of the treatment then to lead to lax and sphincters, healing of the epithelium. Chemical sphincterotomy using injection of botox into the internal sphincter. Advantages of this chemical method gives a more sustained effect than gentian cream. Now, fistula, you know, the fistula is a tract lined with epithelium or granulation tissue which connects two epithelial surfaces, maybe connect to body cavities or one cavity in both external surfaces. The fistula connects lumen of the rectum of anal canal with the external surface and by that granulation tissue. So, the internal opening is below the anorectal end, could be the following, the transsphincter intersphincteric vessel. It could be the lower level transsphincteric, intersphincteric, or subcutaneous or submucous. High level fistula ring opening above the anorectal end, could be the following, the extrasphincteric. Transsphincteric and intersphincteric. So, Park's classification is that intersphincteric, transsphincteric, suprasphincteric, extrasphincteric. Bacteria are purulent discharge from the external opening. Pain is episodic of the fistula, first the pus. The pus doesn't discharge, pain more be intense and thrombing. The discharge causes the pruritus NI, there may be a minor bleeding from the external opening. The symptoms in a general are episodic, but the conditions hardly ever cure itself. So there is a good size rule. Good size rule shows that the internal opening of an anterior fistula lies along the radial line drawn from the external opening to the anus, where the internal opening of the posterior fistula lies in the midline posterior. You can see here in the diagram, there is a radial position. If the midline, if we are talking about the midline, there is an internal external opening over here, it goes radial to the inner of the mucosa of the anal canal. And if you are talking about the posterior, this is posterior, this is the anterior position. If there is a posterior position of the midline, it shows coveriness comes. The external opening is visible anywhere around the anus, usually close to the anal margin, but sometimes a few centimeters away. The opening is not a tender, but the thickened tissue around it may be. Serous or pruritus discharge may be visible. The rectal exhibition is not painful. The internal opening may be felt 2/3 or positive, posterior 1/3 or anterior. Sigmoidoscopy and proctoscopy are essential to exclude underlying disease as a Crohn or carcinoma TB. The minor lymph nodes are not large if there is inflammation or secondary infiltration by carcinoma. Don't forget general examination if there is a suspected systematic underlying cause. If the fistula occurs, fistulogram, endo-anal ultrasound, MRI, these are the investigation you can go for the fistula. Bilateral sinus hemorrhoids and suppurative incontinence, Crohn, thrombus, these are the deficient diagnosis for the fistula. The treatment is superficial and low anal fistulas are laid open. When there is a superficial and low level fistula, you can go to open the fistula. Feel by condition tissue. There is no loss of continuity. This is only done if the fistula lies below the rectal vein. If fistula is suprasphincteric, only the lower part of the fistula is laid open and the non-observable ligature termed as sitor is passed through the param fistula. Two to three weeks. The sphincter is fixed by scar tissue. Subsequent division of the upper part of the tract either by a second operation or tightening of the ligature. Lying open, a whole tract will completely divide. So, inflammatory bowel disease symptoms, pain, ulcerative colitis, and colon disease, lower abdominal cramps, brief the bowel movements, colon disease, constant pain, often the right lower quadrant, bowel movements, stool blood, closely blood stool, and ulcerative colitis. Inflammatory bowel disease, abdominal mass, ulcerative colitis, abdominal mass, colon disease, mass, often in the right lower quadrant, gastrointestinal tract affected by the ulcerative colitis, colon disease, bowel tissue affected, mucosal disease, no granuloma, colon disease, transplant. So this is a deficient type, right? Ulcerative colitis shows only affects only colon and continues from the rectum. Colon disease, mouth to anus, partially affected, discontinuous skin regions. These are basically the ulcerative colitis of the middle mass, but colon disease shows the mass in the right lower quadrant. So this is abdominal deficient diagnosis. Inflammatory bowel disease shows abdominal mass in ulcerative colitis and Crohn disease, sorry, no mass in ulcerative colitis. Gastrointestinal affected. Ulcerative colitis shows only colon and continues from the rectum. Crohn disease can occur in the mouth almost discontinuous skin regions. Labial stickation shows the CBC count, serum nucleus, blood urea, nitrogen, creatinine level, blood grouping across matching population for subjectivity. Focal bleeding test, normal lose 2.5 to 1.5 per day from GIT, three types of tests, white based hematocult, hemocult, two sensor. Good for detecting large, more distal lesions. Inconsistent, need greater than 10 ml daily, loss for positive test for 50% of time. Can detect as little as 1 ml of blood in a stool, affected by dietary factors. Fruits which taken, dark in the stool make it harder to read, fast pulled from dietary iron. This is basically hemocult investigations. Immunochemical do not detect bleeding from upper GI tract, localized to colon. Can detect as little as 0.3 ml of blood in stool. Labels required. Team post foreign test. Very sensitive. High false negative investigation. Fecal bleeding test is 60-80%. And the test is positive patient requires a colonoscopy. R double control bleeding minimum and sigma endoscopy. Test is positive and the colon has been cleared unless antidepressant is present further. Investigation is a bleeding minimum. No rule diagnosis of rectal loggia bleeding. If you use all obscure any subsequent attempts to visualize the electrography of colonoscopy. Double contrast enema is 70% of the rectum. Normal bleeding colonic. Diagnostic and therapeutic capabilities can be used even with ongoing massive bleeding characteristic endoscopic finding of recent upper GI. So colonoscopy show you the all over the colon anatomy and active bleeding vessels. It is a 6-24 hours post presentation. Patient must be stable condition, low bowel preparation, and it is a time and recurrent bleeding disease. Increased risk of small, it could be caused to a bowel preparation, should not be attempted with ischemia or severe mucosal inflammation. So endoscopy may not go for this endoscopy. Endoscopy coagulation. Choose of bleeding area 2% of. 2%. Diverticular bleeding. Will you not be able to endoscopy coagulate? Colonoscopy, virtual colonoscopy may have a role in assessment of patient. Yes, here is a bleeding diverticular. Detects bleeding is a 99-99 colite test, able to detect the slow rates of bleeding. Preferred method, good front term, it bleeds and able to visualize the recipe. Angiography is with a trick angiography, femoral artery punctured, a good specimen in MA. This positive test of exploration of fundamental problem. Can detect hemorrhage tests, 0.5 ml per minute. And an infusion embolization. Normal selective angiogram. city in Gram, new and overwhelming technology requires a modern city scanner, fast, less than 50 per minute. Non-invasive, identifies large and small ball embedded, sensitivity is 72%. Investigation of obscure geography, 5% of patient bleeding, which remains and despite extensive diagnosis, push into enteroscopy, capsule enteroscope, enteroscopy, small ball flow through mucus scan, these investigations, you can go for GI bleeding. If there's obscure GI bleeding, you can go for the Michael scan, the technetium 99 scan, diagnostic laparoscopy, and as for laparotomy, capsule endoscopy. These investigations you can do. Push endoscopy is a 2x7 long thin scope, sound scope, with a balloon tape, this glass is bald. Michael diabetes from women of dental interest. Type disease of two stone, you pick up Michael secretary, you can see Michael 50%. Michael secretary, 85% sensitive, 85% useful for. So it is a logarithm of vessel load bleeding. When you show, when you there the acute load bleeding, you go for the aggressive volume resuscitation. Then you go for the digital rectal examination and exam endoscopy. You have to pass NG tube. If NG tube positive is a bleed, you go for endoscopy and the treatment. If your NG tube is negative, then you can go for DRE to see any endorectal bleeding. If there's endorectal bleeding, you treat it. But if there's a digital rectal bleeding, there's a positive bleed, but there's no any routine bleeding. You can go for, then you have to assess the bleeding. Either it's intermittent bleeding, moderate or massive bleeding. If moderate bleeding, then you can go for the RBC scintigraphy. If the massive bleeding, you can go for mesenteric angiography, and if it's intermittent bleeding, you can go for the colonoscopy. The RBC matrix is positive, you can go for the mesenteric angiography. If the positive in segmental resection, there's a ischemia, obscure, there's anything which is obscure, the mesenteric vessel, you can go for the segmental resection. Positive, then you can go for the. So, if there's a negative, you can go for the intraoperative endoscopy. Then, if there's a positive, you can go for again, you can go for the segmental resection. If there's a negative, you can go for subtotal collector. So the in intermittent bleeding, you go for the colonoscopy. If they're negative, then you have to observe the patient, and then you go for the intraoperative endoscopy. If there is a re-bleeding, then you go to again RBC scintigraphy and to see any confirmation. If there is a colonoscopy is positive, then you go for the endoscopic treatment. If there is a re-bleeding, then you go for the resection. So first the treatment is to start from the endoscopy, then you go for the resection. This is all about the lecture.